Welcome to the first lab of this course. In this session, we're starting with the basics of Docker to lay a strong foundation for understanding containers. By the end of this lab, you'll know how to install Docker and run your first container, work with container options, manage container lifecycles, execute commands, and create interactive sessions, and finally, understand Docker tags. Before we start, I want to tell you that in order to follow all practical lessons in this course, you need to work on a Linux-based operating system. I'll be using Ubuntu. My advice is also that you create a separate virtual machine and you avoid running commands on your own laptop or PC. And I also know that there are some online courses where you get a pre-configured environment that you can access via the browser. But if your goal is to really learn Kubernetes, I think you need to work with the real thing, so you need to manage it all. Now, if you don't already have a VM, there are three options. The first one is that you could use your laptop or PC with some virtualization software, like VMware Workstation, Oracle VirtualBox, or Microsoft Hyper-V. If you have spare hardware, you can set up a home lab with Proxmox. That's the option I use. And the last option is that you can create a VM on a cloud provider. They usually offer a free tier or also some free credit. And keep in mind, you don't need anything special. One or two CPUs are enough, coupled with 2 gigs of RAM. So take your time to create the VM, and once you're done, resume from here. If you have trouble, leave me a comment and I'll try to help you out. Let's get started. Installing Docker is straightforward. You can follow the official documentation, but for this lab, I'll show you an even faster method, which is using a snap. One command and we're done. Beautiful. I check quickly the version and it looks okay. So now we're ready to launch our first container using sudo and the docker run command, followed by hello world. Hello world is the name of the container image hosted on Docker Hub that we want to use. Perfect, it worked. And we also got a message explaining what happened. So the Docker client contacted the Docker daemon running on my machine. The Docker daemon pulled the hello world image from the Docker Hub. And finally, the Docker daemon created a new container from the image, which runs the executable that generated the output we're reading. Now, Docker is encouraging us to do something more ambitious. Let's do it. But as you can see, we're getting a permission error if we try to execute Docker without sudo. To fix that, I'll do some configuration on my account. We can create a Docker group and then add users to it. We make sure the new group is loaded in a new session, and then we disable and re-enable the Docker snap. Now we try to run again the hello world image without sudo, and it works. Perfect. Now we can move to the more ambitious command, but let me explain it first. The I option means that we want to create an interactive session where we can type and interact with the container, while the T instructs Docker to emulate a terminal. And Ubuntu is the name of the image we're going to use from Docker Hub. Finally, bash is the executable we want to interact with in the context of the container. And that's how we get a shell within the Ubuntu container. The commands I'm typing now are executed within the container and not in my VM. In fact, if we list the processes, we can see almost nothing is running. Now it's time to dig a little bit further, and I'm going to use a different image, the Nginx one. I execute Docker run Nginx, and in a few seconds the container is up and running. However, it's running on the foreground, which means that if I press Ctrl C or close the terminal, the process is killed. The way we run it in the background is by using the detach mode option. Now, instead of seeing the typical Nginx output, we get a string, which is the container ID, which we can use to interact with it. For example, we can list the logs using the Docker logs command followed by the ID, and confirmed Nginx was actually started. Now, let's imagine we forget to copy the ID and clear the screen. How can we retrieve it? Well, we use the docker ps command. If you notice, the container has an ID, but also a name. And that can be used instead of the ID. And since it's human readable, it's more practical. So let's try to list the logs using the container name. And as you can see, it works the same. You need to know that Docker always assigns a random name if we don't specify one. So let's try to create a second container with a custom name. And we'll also add another option, which is the publish one, which is used to map a port on my host to a port in the container. In this case, I'm mapping port 8080 on my host to port 80 in the container. This is necessary because the container runs in an isolated environment and its port 80 cannot be reached from the host. If you remember, we had mentioned this in the previous lesson when we were talking about namespaces. Anyway, let's create this container. Now I can see two running containers and one is named MyNginx with its port published as expected. Let's test it out. If I care to localhost on port 8080, I get the Nginx welcome page. Perfect. Now, if I try to care on port 80, I get no response, which is what we expect. Now, the question is, can we execute a command within the context of the container? And the answer is yes. We can use the docker exec followed by the container name and the command we intend to execute. So this time I will execute curl within the container. And as you can see, I can curl on port 80 and I see the Nginx welcome page. Because as we said, the command was executed within the namespace of the container. I could also open an interactive session similarly with what we did with Ubuntu initially. And here is my shell within the container. Let's try a few commands. And it works as expected. Something else we can do with a container running in the background is use the docker attach command to bring it back to the foreground. In this case, we see no logs because nothing is happening. But if I press Ctrl C, I'll kill the process and stop the container. In fact, it's not listed anymore with docker ps. Now, something that might surprise you is that we stopped the container, but we didn't delete it. The container still exists on our host. To see the stop containers, all we do is add the all option to docker ps. And to start a stop container, we can just use the docker start command. And if you really want to get rid of a container, we need first to stop it and then to remove it. So we stop it with docker stop and remove it with docker rm command, like I'm showing. Now, let's say that we are really focused on doing a complete cleanup. We need to keep in mind that the container is not the same thing of the container image that still exists on my host. I can list all the container images using the docker images command. And the way we delete an image is using the docker rmin command, which stands for remove image. However, if we try to remove the Nginx image, we fail because there is still a running container using it. So let's try to remove the lowered image instead. But as you can see, we fail again because the container was stopped but not removed, which means that an image cannot be deleted as long as there is a container referencing it. It doesn't matter if the container is running or stopped. So I'm going to list all containers. I delete the hello world one. And now I can finally get rid of the hello world image as well. Done. As you can see, I list the images and it's not there anymore. Now, there is one more scenario I want to cover in the context of Docker run, which is mounting a volume. This allows the container to read or write data on the host. And why is this useful? Just imagine that you're running a database in a container. If you want to upgrade the database, you need to destroy the old container and replace it with a new one, while keeping the same data folder intact. For this lab, I'm going to use another example. Just imagine that we want to customize the Nginx welcome page. I could create a custom index.html file on my host. I put some nice wording there. Great. Now, to make this work, we need to place this file in a specific directory within the container. And we can do that using the volume option with Docker run. Now, the part before the colon specifies the location on the host, while the part after the colon indicates the target location inside the container. And while we're doing it, I'll also publish this container on a different port. Let's test everything out with care. On port 8080, we see the default Nginx welcome page, while on port 8081, we see our custom page, which is way nicer. Now, let's move to the last topic of this lab, which is tags. So far, we never specified which version of the image we want to pull. But if we browse Docker Hub, we can see that Nginx supports many tags or flavors. To select a specific one, we simply add a colon after the image name, followed by the tag. For example, Docker run Nginx 127 Alpine. When we don't specify a tag, we're implicitly using the latest tag. This tag is just a convention that typically points to the most recent version of an image. And I say typically because nothing prevents someone from tagging an older version as latest. This also means that tags can be updated without notice. Today, the latest tag might point to one image ID, but tomorrow it could point to another. And that's why it's generally advisable to use a specific version tag instead of latest, unless you are experimenting like we're doing in this lab. If you want to be absolutely certain that you're pulling the exact same image every time, you can use the image digest instead of a tag. And the digest can be found on Docker Hub. And to use it instead of a colon, we're going to use the at symbol after the image name, followed by the digest. And as you can see, I managed to launch the Nginx container also using this approach. That's all for this session. And I think you've got plenty to digest, especially if it's your first time using Docker. We covered a lot of ground. We installed Docker and ran containers using images from Docker Hub. We use common options like the publishing ports and mounting volumes. We manage the container lifecycle, executed commands inside the container, and we also created interactive sessions. And finally, we had a brief overview of tags. Now, to reinforce what we've learned, I'm assigning you some exercises to complete in your own time. You'll find them along the notes on my website. The link is in the description. I won't provide you with the solution because I want you to try your best. But if you get stuck, don't hesitate to contact me, leave a comment or send me an email, and I'll do my best to help you out. In the next session, I'll teach you how to create your own image. And if there is time, we'll also cover Docker Compose. Otherwise, I'll create a separate video. Last but not least, remember that this video is part of a full Kubernetes course that I'm offering you for free. All I ask in return is your support to make it visible on YouTube. So write a comment, like, subscribe, and share so that everyone can learn something new.